Welcome to this special conversation en comunidad for Saving Our Land and Saving Our Stories presented by Audible. We're just so excited to connect with all of you today to celebrate the release of Mujeres de Fuego. It actually released today. We'll be exploring the story of the brave woman of Cherán and discuss the spiritual connection between women and la tierra, the importance of protecting our cultura in the midst of climate change, and the sacredness of indigenous identity, as well as learn and from the producer, Elvira, what the process was in creating this audiobook. You just heard a bit of it while you were joining today, so you already have a taste of really how wonderful it is. And for the first 25 of you that joined today, will be receiving via email, the email that you registered with, you will be receiving a gift card, a code, so that you can get free month of Audible Premium, and hopefully you're going to use it to download Mujeres de Fuego, which came out today, as your credit. I would like to introduce you to our host for the next 40, 45 minutes, our friend Christina Igaraividez. Christina is a writer, she's a performer, a producer, and a storytelling coach. She is also ensemble member of Teatro Luna, which is the country's first pan-Latina theater company, and she's also with Teatro Luna West, which is the LA chapter. She is the co-creator of the social media comedy channel Latina-ish TV, and Christina also co-produced the Audible original titled Talking While Female and Other Dangerous Acts that features 25 stories from Latinas across the U.S. on the themes of risk and resilience. So before I hand it over to Christina, why don't we hear a bit of Talking While Female and Other Dangerous Acts?
You're showing me the image on the sonogram. The doctor confirmed the pregnancy. And in this moment, I suddenly felt the heaviness of the situation. And I sat there crying in her office. How could this little black and white picture determine my future? The future that I had so carefully planned to live overseas, eat exotic food, and live life out of my suitcase. My adventure came to a stop. After returning to the present, the doctor explained that she wouldn't report this to the police and that she would help me throughout the process. Report a pregnancy to the police? ¿Qué? I mean, wasn't I suffering enough? She explained that since Dubai is a Muslim country, it follows the Sharia law and that sex out of marriage is illegal and considered a crime. As an expat living overseas, I had often heard stories and rumors of people getting in trouble for kissing in public and women being imprisoned for having a child out of wedlock. But I never thought that I would face this real problem.
Christina, that's beautiful. Welcome, welcome, amiga. I'm so excited to have you here today, and the stage is all yours. I'm going to hand it off to you.
Thank you so much, Anna. I'm Christina, and thank you for hosting this event. Just a quick background, that clip was from our Audible original, Talking While Female and Other Dangerous Acts. And it was a story of a friend of mine. All the stories are true and real. And I actually had to voice over that story for her because she had to conceal her identity because she was still living in Dubai. And what happened to her was illegal. She no longer lives there. And she kind of regrets not using her real name, but now at least she has that story published and out there forever. So I invite you all to check it out. But aside from that, as Anna mentioned, I am so honored to be sharing this special conversation about another wonderful Audible original coming out today called Mujeres de Fuego. And we're joined today by Elvira Liceaga, producer and co-writer of Mujeres de Fuego. She's narrated audiobooks, independent documentaries, radio and TV commercials. She's a frequent contributor to a lot of publications such as Este País. She was an editor at Vice in Español and currently is the production coordinator at La Corriente de Golfo podcast. So we'd love to first hear a preview of Mujeres de Fuego, which has released on Audible today, as we mentioned, before we start the conversation.
Ellas dicen que solo se cobijaron el rebozo, se persignaron y dijeron, pues vamos a hacerlo. Entonces dicen que sí tenían mucho miedo, que unas a otras se dijeron, Ay, pero usted no tiene miedo. Pues sí, sí tengo miedo, pero ¿qué vamos a hacer? Ya estamos aquí, ya, de una vez. Si no es ahorita, quién sabe cuándo.
Iban rumbo al cerro cuando encontraron los primeros camiones cargados de madera y los detuvieron. Y ahí les empezaron a decir que pues ya no tardaran, que quién les había dado permiso, y empezó el alegato.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Elvira, I don't know if you wanted to say anything first about the clip we just heard.
Well, first I want to say thank you for organizing this. I'm new to this community of Latina women and I love to be part of it. And I'm so happy that you chose Mujeres de Fuego to make this event. I know there are a lot of great podcasts out there and it's hard to choose. And I think our team is honored, and I can speak for them, for all of us, that you chose to focus your attention in this story, that it's about great women and a great community in Mexico City who has a lot to teach us.
Awesome, thank you so much. Yeah, I was able to listen to it ahead of time, and it's just so many powerful quotes and stories from the Cherán women themselves, which is really beautiful to have here in their own words, you know, their experiences with the story. I wanted to know first, how did you even learn about what these women were doing, the women of Cherán?
Well, it all happened like this. A journalist who is called Heriberto Paredes, years ago, he was covering one of Javier Sicilia's march to end violence in Mexico City. And I don't know if you guys know who he is, but he's a poet whose son was murdered and he began a peace movement in Mexico. So this journalist, Heriberto, was in the march. He was covering the march and he saw a cardboard that said Cherán en pie de lucha, which in English would be like Cherán is up in the fight. So he was like, what's that? What's Cherán? Why are they fighting? What are they fighting for? So he went to Cherán, and when he got there, the town was closed. And all he saw was improvised walls made of sacks of sand and a lot of people with their face covered asking you, who are you and why do you want to get in and what do you want? So at the end, he got in and he realized that the town was in a state of pausa, of a stop. It was an extraordinary moment. It was not regular life going on there. It was weird. It was interesting. The schools were closed. The stores were closed. The restaurants were closed. Nobody was living like a regular life. No one was following their usual routines. Everybody was not inside their houses. Everybody was outside their houses on the streets around fogatas, which I think it's fire pits or wood fire. And that's why we call this story Mujeres de Fuego. And he made an investigation. He showed it to one of us. We made a team. We loved the story. And we choose the title he thought of, Mujeres de Fuego, because fire is a symbol of strength, fuerza, of power, of union. It's also a symbol of emergency and, you know, the light shows the way, the light shows where the help is, the light shows where the danger is, the light is life. So Mujeres de Fuego started with this research by Heriberto Paredes and other two journalists. And we said, let's make it a podcast, you know, like in a friendly format that just seeps into daily lives of people. And let's see if everybody will get as inspired as we were by the story.
I love that. And where is Cherán located approximately?
Cherán is in the Sierra Purépecha, in La Meseta Purépecha in Michoacán, which is a Mexican state, which is, by the way, very rich in terms of natural resources. It's a state with coast, it's a state with minerals, it's a state with poppy, it's a state with plenty of forest. And the forest is a very important part of this story. The forest is the house, it's the spirit, is the leitmotif of the story. So Cherán is in a place of forest. That's the image I want to share.
I love that. I know, it's so interesting, even though it's audio format, I really felt like I was there. And the words of the women are just so, they take you to different worlds, honestly. And one of the things that really stuck out to me listening to the audiobook that I shared with you was a part where one of the women talked about healing someone with plants and herbs, you know, and afterwards she goes to her mom and says, "Mom, I healed this person." And her mom says, "No, you didn't. You didn't heal her. You plus a whole array of resources, of natural forces came together to nourish the plants, to nourish the trees, to create the herbs that all came together to heal this woman together." And I just thought that was so powerful and wanted to know just any, what are the biggest takeaways that came out of working on this project for you personally?
Well, that part that you mentioned is incredibly inspiring and incredibly like revealing for us to understand their relationship with nature and how that relationship with territory is spiritual. One of the most important things for us to understand to tell the story was that, first of all, we can no longer think of territory as an extension of land. You know, we have to think of territory as people, the language, the Purépecha culture, the Purépecha language, beliefs, culture, daily ways of living, how they treat each other, how they think of community, of collective social dynamics. So that was one of the main learnings, I think, for me, as we get to know the story and as we kept listening to the testimonials, the testimonies of these women who started the movement and who tell the story. And that part that you mentioned, that they have another relationship with nature that we, the ones who live in cities, we don't have, sadly. And to realize the importance of the forest for the people in Cherán was like mind-blowing, because it's not only the place that gives them food and wood and water. It's a place where they perform sacred rituals. It's a place where they find meaning, for where they found sense. It's their home, but it's like a spiritual home, like a physical home too. You know, it's different. And yes, they see, I think, the cycles of nature with so much humility and so much respect that they realize they cannot disturb that cycle. No, that's why these women who are healers had to learn that they don't heal. What heals is the sun, the water, the herbs, the environment, no? So they try to join that cycle of nature, but without disrupting it, which is like the opposite of civilization.
Yeah, quite the opposite of what's going on. Obviously, we could learn so much from every indigenous tribe, and especially women, who hold so much wisdom about the land, that I wish every single person on earth can hear more of these stories, or actually would do it. You know, it's not that they're not out there. These stories are out there for the public. So thank you for mentioning that and reminding us of all of that too. So speaking of the woman in the story, we find them to be so dynamic, like we mentioned. And was just wondering, how do you think this story really challenges or redefines the role of women, or the role that women play in our society, and how did they challenge that?
Wow. Well, they are challengers. I mean, these are women who this is a story. I'm going to give a little bit of background. This is the story of a community that was victim for years of illegal logging. At some point, their forest was being illegally logged until up to the 70% of the forest. They began to run out of water. They began to be afraid. The loggers were in the community, in the town, and the people was unsafe because they were carrying big guns and there was a lot of violence, murders, kidnappers, kidnapping, disapparition, desapariciones.
Disappearances.
Yeah, thank you. So the community at first began to try regular ways of stopping this, going to the local authorities or going with the loggers and said, please don't do this. And the loggers were very, very, very violent. And I'm, of course, this is, it's more complex than this, but this is a summary. And these women, one morning, very early in the morning, saw the trucks going up to the forest to cut the wood. And they say, let's go and stop them. A group of maybe six women, we don't know how many exactly because they did this in a collective, anonymous, you know, they say, no fue una, fuimos todas. It wasn't one, we were all. And they were with their rebozos and they pick up some stones in the way and they say, stop. To the loggers, to that group of loggers. And they put their bodies and they didn't have guns. And it was the first step of a non-violent resistance that it's still going on in Cherán. And, you know, that's just a little proof of how brave and challenging the traditional roles of women, this story shows it can be, no? We focus on the voices of women because they started the movement and because they became a huge part of the resistance. After they, well, they kind of kidnapped these loggers and then the community, of course, was afraid that they organized crime, which was in Mexico, organized crime and state are like indistinguishable, you know, it's the same. So they were afraid of the consequences and the community had to stop. That's when the journalists I told you at the beginning get to the town. So they started a moment of stopping. And we as a society never stop. They say, let's stop. What are we gonna do? How are we gonna to protect themselves? What are we gonna do to with our future? How are we going to invent a new way of organizing ourselves? And they ended up coming up with a self-government and a resistance. So the way they did this was with fire pits in the streets because they needed to keep an eye on the community. They needed to protect the community because maybe the narcos were coming for them. They put a price on their heads of Cherán people. So when they take the fire intuitively to the streets, so no one stays in their houses where they can protect them and they become like a outdoor society at some point. The women began to take out the things they used to cook, you know, like pans and the food and everything you need to cook. So the women who have always been excluded of the places where politics takes place were at the center of the politics, were at the center of the moment and the space where the decisions of the future of the community were done, no? So it's interesting and very important for me how the kitchen becomes a public space and a place and a thing that it's a kitchen that it's traditionally a women's place. Now it's everybody's place and it's where everything is decided.
So many ways. Wow. And thank you for giving us that summary. I saw a few comments in the chat. So brave. Wow. Just to imagine those women, you know, using nothing but their bodies to stop these loggers was an incredible act. And thank you for giving us that background because I think it was so important to know too that this is what they did. This really is happening and was started by these women. And aside from, aside from the story itself, I wanted to know, like, have you ever worked on a project like this? And just anything that kind of, for anyone who would be interested in going into producing stories like this and have a desire to make sure that stories like this get published and are heard, anything that you've learned from producing the project, the process, or that stuck out to you maybe?
Well, last year we launched another documentary podcast called La Advertencia about a historic moment in Guatemala's recent history in which justice was finally achieved after decades of impunity. That's like the official description, but it's a very exciting story about the power of the people in Guatemala taking over the public space to demand justice. And it was a totally different experience. And one of the things that Mujeres de Fuego taught us, I think, and which was very important for me, and I think you can relate to that because your podcast does it too, is that when we heard this story, when we read the investigation by this journalist, we had to think how do we tell this story and how do we make it attractive, because you have to do that, and what does the story needs, you know, what are the needs of the story? And we decided to tell it with their testimonies. So one of the main one of the principal things for me is how to tell a story without telling it and let them tell it, you know, how do you give voice to the ones who were there? How do you don't appropriate what it's not yours? So we make a choral story. So when you listen to Mujeres de Fuego, you're gonna listen to a lot of women. And sometimes maybe you would not distinguish who is who, but that's okay because it doesn't matter really. They're like a communal voice. It's a chorus of strength, of voices, of narrative. And we wanted to do that, you know, like to put the testimony at the center of the narrative, because that for me and for all the team of writers was the more humble way to make it appealing, you know? And I think you have that in your podcast too. Like you put the testimony and you are, maybe you agree that we're in a new, I'm not sure if we're in a new, but I think we're in a moment of narratives in literature, in podcasts, in documentaries, visual documentaries, that testimonies are the main thing because, we want to listen to those eyes, no? To those, in Spanish we would say, we want to listen to those yo's that live it.
I totally agree. I was just writing notes down because I'm like, oh my gosh, so much of you said sparked so many things. Storytelling has obviously been around for a long, long time in various formats, but I think more formats have exploded with you know, more advances in technology, in, you know, new companies springing up that are creating these outlets, these apps, these services, right? So now it's imperative now more than ever, if you have a story to tell it, right? And I think as a society, we're just constantly seeking truth too, and figuring out what is real, what is unbiased, you know, and a great way to do that is to focus on, is nonfiction personal narrative work, which I think, I mean, you can't argue of someone's personal story, right? Because it is the ultimate truth, someone's ultimate
truth. Yeah. And also I think that we're in a moment in narrative that we don't need to argue. We need to listen, and we want to listen, and that's great. And we listen a lot of stories about looted territories, illegal markets that end up in empires where used to be indigenous communities, you know, like drugs, palm oil in Brazil, in Honduras, avocado in Mexico. And we hear a lot of stories about oppression and looting and violence, but we never, we never hear the stories of resistance, of fight, of success, of peace movements, of nonviolent ways of defending the territory. So that's why we think this is an important story to tell and to share, because this is an inspiring story, and we need to hear more about them. And we fortunately got Natalia Lafourcade interested in sharing this story. So she's a voice that it's great for me, because like most of testimony literature nowadays, it's a voice that shares, it's a voice that wants to know, it's a voice that feels that it's discovering the story. It's not a voice with authority that wants to tell you the story that she didn't live. She just wants to listen too. So we gathered together like a few points of view and elements and this great, amazing, inspiring story. And that's it. We'll see if it's as appealing as we think it would.
Yes, I think so. I don't think you have to worry about that. Awesome. Thank you so much, Elvira. I think we're just at time for questions. But thank you so much for telling us everything that you have about the stories and about working on it. I think we probably have a lot more that we could dive into, but people are just going to listen to the stories themselves on Audible starting today. And now I would like to just shift over to a few questions from the audience, and we'll bring you up to the stage. And the first one is from Julia Montoya, and her question is, where are they now with their movement and what changed?
Well, now this 2021, it's 10 years since the resistance began. So they're very wise when they think about their future, and they made a 30 year long, I don't know how to say that, like a 30 year plan, you know? So they're in their first 10 years. They plan the resistance in a long term for 30 years. So they are like keeping going. They have a lot of challenges. It's hard to keep a resistance going on. It's definitely the difficult path. They managed to get the political parties and organized crime out of the community. They don't have that, but they are being, they want to be there, you know, the traditional politics in Mexico, they want to get in. So they have to fight that all the time. So they are working on it. It's a never ending story. And they had a great success because they managed to make the federal Mexican government to respect their self-government. So they are legally allowed to self-govern by usos y costumbres, customs and I don't know if traditions if is the exact word. So they have, even though they have this, they have won this legal fight, they still have to work daily to maintain or keep the resistance going on. They also have challenges, for example, to include the younger generations of people from Cherán to get involved in politics, which is hard.
No, I can imagine that 100%. And thank you for answering that for us. I think Ana was gonna jump in for a sec.
Yeah, so actually I have a question for Elvira and then for both of you. So Elvira, last year I went on this beautiful trek in Oaxaca llamado Camino Copalita, and it was mm-hmm. all led by the local communities, indigenous communities, that formed a cooperativa, right? And as we were coming down from La Sierra Sur de Oaxaca all the way down to Huatulco, via the Rio Copalita, what we were learning about was these communities had really had united for many years and had been driving Monsanto away, right? And they were able to like regenerate their land, and we could, and there was places where they would show us like, these are the communities that banded together to, you know, to learn. First of all, it was the education and them learning, et cetera. And then they would show us like, literally it was incredible how it was marked in the forest where we could see the other communities that didn't want to go through the process because it's easier to, you know, continue growing the way that they are, agriculture and everything. And like the differences, right? And just the way of thinking and everything when they're at the end of the day, son comunidades zapotecas. So my question is, because I know you also work in Guatemala and I see that you know, the type of work that you do, what do you think is that difference? That kind of was just so impressed when you were saying that when the women in Cherán united, they did it all together, right? It's like todas por una, una por todas, como sería. It was all of them. And just that mentality, like, what do you think brings that, you know, that sense of knowing when to protect your land and doing it from that place of it doesn't matter what it takes, right? That they have the vision that this is the legacy that needs to be that needs to be done. And like I said, they're the guardians of the earth right now.
Well, collectivity is like so fundamental. It's essential in the fight. They have communal lands. Communal lands means that the communal, that like the lands, it's, they belong to everybody and they belong to nobody. So that's like a start for us to understand what's communality when we think about it, because we're not used to it. The people in the cities and urbanizations were not raised like that. So they did a very simple and wise rewind to see how their ancestors have fought before. Because defenders of territory or of land, they have been fighting for ages. Mm-hmm. So they ask themselves, how did we did it before? Who are we? What does our identity tell us about this challenge? What does they call the elders, grandmas and grandpas? What can they tell us? They learn from them. They learn from their history. And that's when they recover, for example, in the case of Cherán, figures like La Ronda Comunitaria, which is like their own police, but I don't want to use the word police, but it's something like that. They have this group of people who are people from the community that get together and protect the community, making rounds in the forest, some in the town. And they realize they have a lot of answers in their own story. And they recover structures and models of protecting themselves, of protecting the forest, of recovering the forest once they took it back. So communality and collectivity, it's part of the history of them. It's not new. What they had to do is like unlearn a lot of modern things and a lot of structures that the politics as we know it impose. So that was very impressive for us, because it's not that they came up with a new whole thing that they have never even think about it. They knew it. It was in their history.
I love it. Thank you. I'm gonna step off because I think we have Angela and Julia that we can bring to the stage. I have questions. Gracias. Thanks for, that was beautiful.
My pleasure.
Awesome. Yes, Angela Chavez, if you could unmute and or
we have to give her we have to allow her. So I think the team is on.
Hi. I would love to be on camera, but today is not the day. Thank you all. This is really a lovely conversation. I'm curious just to know, I do a lot of narrative storytelling around some of the more disadvantaged communities in the States here in California. And I have sometimes come across, you know, some folks that have really compelling stories, but are reluctant or hesitant to share their stories. And I'm wondering if there was like what the story gathering process was like for you all, and if there was much reluctance from any of the women. And now looking back, do you feel like there were possibly any voices missing from the story? I know that's like a 5-part question.
Well, at first we had testimonies from the first investigation I told you about. We had that written and we had the audios. So we realized that, of course, not every voice was the same. They didn't tell the story in the same way because they were different persons and they were in different places when the story began. So part of the idea of making a choral story or a choral structure in the narrative was that we wanted to show that the truth or that the memory or that the history, not in a way of the history with capital H, but the history, you know, the one we own, not the one they tell us, that the memory of it had to be collective, had to be like a mosaic. How do you say mosaic? Mosaic?
Yeah.
So we embrace that and we make it a thing, you know, like show it up front. Memory is collective, especially in this kind of life-changing stories for our community. So we had some voices at the beginning, and we realized, for example, Melita is a great talking about the relationship with the forest, with the plants. She's a healer. She has a radio show in the local community radio. Ave was also, she's also a healer. So she's great talking about how they don't heal, but nature heals, and how they were afraid when the narcos was taking over the community. Alicia she's a lawyer, so she's great of talking of political processes and legal battles. So we began to make like a puzzle of different skills they had, you know, different point of views, and make like a puzzle of different experiences to make it one with all. So of course, we could always had thousands of voices in the podcast. That would be very chaotic in the making. But we really like that all of them were sharing their voice in a non-selfish way. You know, they weren't like trying to start the story at all. On the contrary, they were saying, this is my part of my version of it. Because they have collectivity in their own state of mind. It's not like us. And collectivity for an outsider to understand, it's almost impossible. Like I'm still, if I can manage to understand a little bit about how they embrace and interiorize collectivity, I would be so lucky, you know? So I don't know, did I answer your question?
Yeah, I'm just wondering if any of the women had reluctance or hesitant to talk to you guys. If there were any that were worried about the story getting out or their names or what attention could come of it.
Yeah, I think it happened. It happened. But I don't know the reasons why, you know? But we try to be respectful to everybody's wishes.
Thank you. That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Great question. And I'm going to move us to Julia Montoya, if you want. Oh, let me unmute you. And if you want to open your camera up, that's totally up to you as well. But if you want to ask your question.
Oh, I can't unmute the screen or the not letting me.
Oh, it's not letting you video. Okay. I think someone's working on it.
Yeah, now it should.
Okay. So you can see my hair in all its glory with no hair product. Well, my question is kind of piggybacking on like what was said last. How do you feel as a storyteller? Is there any fear on your part? Because I'm pretty sure that's what the females were feeling, some fear of backlash, and that's their community and they have to deal with it every day. Do you feel like that as a storyteller, and how do you stay motivated?
Do you want to answer, Christina? That's also for you. I mean, your podcast is about radical stories too.
Yes. Personally, I don't know. I think I've done so many fearful things that I've been fortunate enough to surround myself with a collective of women who run towards fear and embrace it instead of second guess. So it's, for me as a creator, has become kind of second nature to me. And I know that I am so fortunate in that. And I just want every woman to feel that way and to find that for themselves, that collective. And even if it's just one other person, right? Because we feed off each other. And that's how we find our own voice too. You know, we're not born with our personal voice, right? We take things from people we admire, you know, throughout our lives and take notice of those things, you know, of the people that you are surrounding yourselves with. And if they are running towards fear, if they are open to things that could make you more brave, you know, and explore those things. So I am relearning those things since the pandemic, I have to say, since I'm a little out of practice, but in general, I think we need to, you know, for anyone who's feeling lost, storyteller or not, or unsure, know you're not alone, and that we just need to keep practicing. Every day we have the opportunity to do something, take a small brave action that will ultimately create, you know, this greater confidence and bravery that the purpose takes over the fear, right? And the mission is just bigger than the fear. from my experience. I don't know, Elvira, if you want to chime in.
I think we were afraid for them. We probably shouldn't have to, because they are stronger than we can imagine, as you're going to figure it out when you listen to the podcast. But sometimes you're afraid when you showcast or broadcast other voices that are not yours, no? I mean, generally.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Julia, and thanks for coming on camera. That was a brave act in itself, coming onto camera. Thank you. Okay, I think we have one last question from Eliana. See if we could unmute. And if you want to go on video, that is totally your choice too.
Yeah, I'm trying to, I think I'm having the same issue. Okay, wait, I think I might be able to. Okay, hi guys. It's so great to hear you guys amplifying these stories and their voices. And I just wanted to know what steps you think us and the general public can take to better support these movements. And if there's anything specifically from those that you've talked to that they want to see support from. Does that question make sense? I can clarify more.
How could we support them?
Yes, I guess if there's any specific actions that maybe they have expressed, because I know a lot of these stories, they don't get a lot of amplification. So what you guys are doing is great, but if there's anything that they specifically want, like the general, you know, mass public, if there's anything we can be doing to better be like allies and support movements like this.
Well, I would like to think that when people listen to the podcast, will go into their own process of being conscious of how we're all connected, and these stories of the defending the territory affect us, even if nobody tells us to. So that's why. That's one of the reasons we tell the story, of course. But I think that, or I hope that this process is in every person different, and they would come up, they would experience some awareness and realize how their daily lives can be, can go through small changes and big changes in order to support them, you know, like, I think that more than a call to action, we can place the hope in self-conscious and review of that you go by yourself and your family and your friends or your partner or your roommates about how you live your life, how you treat each other, how you think of the world, how you think of nature, how you think of women, of course. So for me, it would be great if the podcast has invisible effects in people, and people will make changes by themselves. Of course, you can support some things that I think, for example, in the case of Cherán and other indigenous communities' fights to defend the territory are great. For example, what you eat, how you consume. But I think one of the things that are great pieces of the fight are community radios. After I did this podcast with the team, we realized that community radios are very important in Cherán and in a lot of indigenous communities in Mexico and a lot of Latin America, because they are a piece of togetherness. You know, they're like a glue. They help to keep alive the Purépecha or the indigenous language. They help to be to get to know each other, to see what's going on with your neighbor, who has more spinach than they need, who sells a chair, who is in danger, who is being afraid because saw something dangerous. So it's like a way of local communication, very, very important. And I started with a friend. I mean, it hasn't gone too far, but I hope it will, like a donation project of headphones and microphones and speakers, which they need in local community radios because they don't have money for the equipment. So I don't know, that's what came up to me because I'm a radio host and a broadcaster. So I thought they need headphones. I know what they need, no, but I probably, it will have a different effect on you. How do you live your life and how do you connect to the story?
That's amazing. Yeah, thank you. Definitely being like introspective, right? And like looking to see how we can all make a change in our ways. And that's really cool to hear about the radio. Yeah, that's awesome.
And also just from a, I think, practical standpoint, to continue to give power to more stories told by indigenous peoples, Latinx, Latine people is always, it's always in the numbers too. So if you do download, ratings help, comments help,
yeah,
you know, that show the people in power that these stories are worthy, these stories are impactful, right? Because it's one thing to just think it and say it, but it's another thing to show proof of it, right? So that is always helpful to continue to move these stories forward. And I totally agree with Elvira, every small action that we take to help our environment and the world around us really does make an impact, no matter how small we think it is. I know a lot of us would love to just, you know, just do everything, like, take out all the stuff in the world and like do away with it. Don't even get me started on like factory farming and things like that. But, you know, doing our research and our part, however we can. So yeah. I wanted to thank you all, Mujeres de Fuego, Elvira, and all of you here today for spending time with us. It has been such a great hour, and remember to visit Audible to download Mujeres de Fuego and Talking About Female and Other Dangerous Acts to discover more Latinx, Latine voices from stories across the world. Thank you. And I'll bring it over to Ana.
I am obsessed with both of you. I just need to like sit down and have a tea or a vinito or something with a whole night and listen to all your stories. Thank you so much, both of you, for sharing from the heart. Elvira, for really going after the stories that truly matter. And you can count on us to really be there to support you as you continue driving these voices and these stories out to the world. You can count on this community of your new community of We All Grow Latina. So
yeah.
Again, thank all of you for joining us today. And we really hope that today's conversation, Saving Our Land and Saving Our Stories presented by Audible and We All Grow, has inspired you all one way or another to keep elevating your voices and stories and to continue to celebrate culture through media. So just remember again to share your takeaways with us from today's conversation, and remember to tag us at WeAllGrow, at Audible. And we have also shared the handles of our guests. And if you feel that a friend needs to listen to this, you'll be getting the link to the recording soon and you can go ahead and share it. And again, the first 25 that join will be getting your code for Audible Premium. And we hope that you will use that credit to download and listen to Mujeres de Fuego. Like Christina was saying, it is super important that we show the love right now so that these stories keep getting funded and keep getting shared, and that those voices of wisdom connect and get to the heart and soul where they need to be. Otra vez, muchas, muchas gracias a todas. Gracias,
Elvira. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good night.
It was an honor.